Hello. This video is about maxillofacial and dental emergencies, and it is not intended to cover all details of this branch. It will cover the important points with some tips for the exam. According to the curriculum of the Royal College, maxillofacial and dental emergencies include the topics that you see now. Note that some topics are already covered with other branches, so we will not talk about them here. Let's start talking about the important details of these topics, and let's start with mandibular and temporomandibular joint injuries. First, you should know that the orthopontomogram is the best X-ray technique for the accurate diagnosis of mandibular fractures and temporomandibular joint dislocations. A helical CT scan is an accurate method of diagnosis if X-rays are technically impossible. For temporomandibular joint dislocations, approximately 90% of all cases of temporomandibular joint dislocations are bilateral and anterior, and the most common cause is excessive mouth opening whilst yawning. A bilaterally dislocated temporomandibular joint is indicated by an open mouth that the patient is unable to close. Malocclusion most commonly indicates either a unilateral dislocation or fracture of the mandible. Also, a tilted or asymmetrical position of the mandible may indicate a unilateral dislocation or a displaced mandibular fracture. The standard intraoral technique for reduction of the anteriorly dislocated temporomandibular joint is designed to push the mandible inferiorly and posteriorly back into the mandibular fossa. This can be done from either an anterior or posterior approach. Dislocations to the posterior, medial or lateral side are usually associated with a fracture of the mandible and should be referred to a maxillofacial surgeon for reduction. Once the mandible has been relocated, the patient must have a repeat X-ray to confirm the position and to exclude a fracture occurring on reduction. Discharge advice must include eating a soft diet in the first few days, avoiding wide mouth opening for the next 2 weeks, and supporting the mouth with the hand if yawning or laughing. An encircling bandage, which is called Barton bandage, to support the mandible is usually unnecessary unless the patient is unable to understand or comply with discharge advice. All patients should be followed up by a maxillofacial specialist. Now let's move to mandibular fractures. Fractures of the mandible are the second most common facial fracture seen in the emergency department after nasal fracture. The site of fracture is localized to three main areas. The body of the mandible accounts for approximately one-third of fractures. The condylar head and neck and coronoid process account for another third. And the ramus and other areas account for the final third. You should know when to suspect mandibular fractures. For example, the presence of hematoma in the sublingual space is indicative of a mandibular fracture. Also, the tongue blade test may aid in diagnosing mandibular fracture, in combination with other clinical findings. In this test, a wooden spatula is held between the patient's teeth on each side of the mandible and the examiner applies a twisting force. A positive test is one where the patient is unable to hold the blade whilst pressure is applied. You should know the Manchester Mandibular Fracture Decision Rule, which is used to determine the possibility of mandibular fractures and the need for X-ray imaging. This rule includes the following questions. 1. Do the patient's teeth meet abnormally, or has malocclusion? 2. Is the patient unable to open his or her mouth normally, or has trismus? 3. Does the patient have any broken teeth? 4. Does the patient report pain while their mouth is closed? 5. Is there a step deformity? If the answer is yes to any of these questions, then request a mandibular X-ray. And as we mentioned, the orthopontomogram is the most accurate technique. A helical CT scan of the mandible is an accurate method of diagnosis if X-rays are technically impossible. Patients with an open mandibular fracture should be given a broad-spectrum antibiotic whilst in the emergency department. Lacerations to the gum mucosa almost always indicate an open fracture of the mandible. Now, let's move to the zygomatic complex and nasal injuries. There are some signs that are indicative of specific zygomatic complex and nasal fractures. For example, Persistent bleeding and/or discharge from the nose may indicate a naso-ethmoidal fracture. Depression of the zygomatic arch, which is known as flattened face, indicates zygomatic arch fracture. And this is best identified by looking from above or below. Enophthalmos and proptosis both indicate a significant orbital injury. Eye movement, particularly upward gaze, may be restricted in orbital blowout fractures due to trapping of the herniated inferior rectus muscle. There are different imaging methods that are used to diagnose zygomatic complex, orbital and nasal fractures. For the diagnosis of zygomatic complex fractures, two facial X-ray views are recommended, which are the occipitomental 15 and occipitomental 30 views. These views are the recommended combination of facial views to maximize pickup rates and minimize radiation exposure. A spiral facial CT scan is far more accurate at identifying zygomatic complex and zygomatic arch fractures, but its use in the emergency department is restricted to a second-line investigation. The diagnosis of orbital blowout fracture may be made on routine facial X-rays, but CT scan remains the gold standard if this injury is suspected or identified. In orbital blowout fractures, a teardrop sign, for example, is used to diagnose orbital blowout fractures. For nasal fractures, it is now universally recognized that X-rays of the nasal bones are unnecessary as they do not alter management of the injury. Nasal fractures are covered under the branch of ENT emergencies. In zygomaticomaxillary injuries, patients should be given general advice regarding their injury, including avoidance of nose blowing, as this may produce surgical emphysema, not to occlude the nose when sneezing, application of ice packs to the area to reduce swelling, taking regular analgesia. Now, let's talk a little bit more about the orbital floor fracture. In an orbital blowout fracture, the pressure from a direct blow involving the relatively tough globe is transmitted downwards, fracturing the floor of the orbit, and often results in herniation of intraocular contents into the maxillary sinus. The clinical features of orbital blowout fractures include enophthalmos, diplopia and ophthalmoplegia, particularly of the upward gaze, due to trapping of the herniated inferior rectus muscle. Orbital emphysema due to fracture into the adjacent paranasal sinus, usually the maxillary sinus. Malar region numbness, due to injury to the infraorbital nerve. Subconjunctival hemorrhage with the posterior border cannot be seen. The diagnosis may be made on routine facial X-rays, as we mentioned, and a teardrop sign, for example, appear in the X-ray. This teardrop sign is caused by soft tissue herniating through roof of maxillary sinus. But CT scan remains the gold standard, but it is not the first imaging modality in the emergency department. Now, let's move to Lafort fractures. Lafort fractures are fractures of the midface, which collectively involve the separation of all or a portion of the midface from the skull base. Fracture of the pterygoid plates is mandatory to diagnose Lafort fractures, as these plates are the structures that connect the midface to the sphenoid bone dorsally. CT is the imaging modality that is used to detect this type of fracture. The classification of Lafort fractures is as follows. Lafort type 1 means horizontal fracture through the maxilla above the roots of the teeth. Lafort type 2 means a pyramidal fracture in which teeth are at the pyramid base and the nasofrontal suture at its apex. Lafort type 3 means a transverse fracture causing craniofacial disjunction. The entire face is separated from the skull. Now, let's move to dental trauma. The adult human has 32 permanent teeth. Each tooth is given a name according to its position in terms of upper or lower, U or L, right or left, R or L. The order starting from the front, 1, 2, 3, etc. So, for example, the upper left central incisor is given the name UL1. You should know the types of teeth fractures. The teeth fractures may be enamel fracture, which is limited to the enamel only. Enamel and dentine fracture, which is extending through both enamel and dentine but not extending into the dental pulp. complicated crown fracture, which is a fracture through the tooth extending into the dental pulp. It is also known as an enamel dentine pulp fracture, root fracture, which is a fracture of the apical portion of the tooth which involves dentine, pulp and cementum. Alveolar bone fracture, which is a fracture of the alveolar process of the maxilla or mandible, which may or may not involve the socket itself. For management, if a primary tooth has been avulsed, then it should not be implanted. If a primary tooth is very loose and presents a potential airway risk, then it should be removed. The avulsed permanent tooth should be held in a physiologically acceptable medium before reimplantation. The physiologically acceptable media are saliva or milk. So, the patient can keep the tooth inside his mouth, or it can be put in milk. While holding a tooth by hand, it is important to hold it at the crown only, the part that is normally visible in the mouth, and to avoid touching the root surface. Teeth that are outside of the mouth for more than 60 minutes are more likely to fail. Now, let's move from dental trauma to dental infections, and let's talk about dental abscess. Bacteria associated with dental infections include oral Streptococcus bacteria and anaerobes. Dental abscess is usually polymicrobial. For dental abscess, definitive treatment can only be given by a dentist and medication will not eliminate the source of infection. Antibiotics are generally not indicated for otherwise healthy people at low risk of complications when there are no signs of spreading infection. If an oral antibiotic is indicated, prescribe a 5-day course of either amoxicillin or phenoxymethylpenicillin, or clarithromycin if there is penicillin allergy. Consider concomitant treatment with metronidazole if the infection is severe or spreading. Advise use of analgesic to relieve symptoms. The complications of dental abscess include loss of the affected tooth, fistula or sinus formation, spread of infection to any of the adjacent structures, Ludwig's angina, sepsis, and airway obstruction. Ludwig's angina is a bilateral infection of the submandibular, the sublingual, and the submental spaces. The clinical features include fever, rigors, and malaise, mouth pain, stiff neck, drooling, dysphagia, muffled voice or aphasia, dyspnea, stridor, cyanosis, tender symmetrical woody induration in the submandibular area. The diagnosis is based on clinical findings and supported by CT. Treatment is by empiric broad-spectrum antibiotics. Surgery is usually not necessary unless a local abscess is identified by CT or MRI.